to QCAN webinar number 36. My name is Kuan Yu Liu. I'm a staff scientist here at QCAN in Pleasanton. The webinar will be roughly an hour long. I'd like to invite you to submit your questions in the little question box here in the GoToWebinar control panel. And you may submit the questions during the talk, and I will go through them at the end and present them to the speaker. At the end of this webinar, it will take you to the page asking for feedback. Any suggestions are greatly appreciated. Now, it's my pleasure to introduce Professor Anna Krylov today. She is the Gabelin Distinguished Professor in Science and Engineering and a professor at the University of Southern California. Professor Krylov acquired numerous honors and awards, including Dirac Medal and the most recent Plyler Award from American Physical Society. Professor Krylov is president of QCAM and also a QCAM developer. Her group has been focusing on theoretical model of open shell and electronically excited species. Today, she'll be speaking to us on core level spectroscopy. Without further ado, I'd like to turn over to our speaker.
All right, thank you, Kuan Yu, for introduction, and thank you everyone for attending. So I will be talking about core level spectroscopy, which is an exciting frontier in experimental science and also in theory. So let me begin telling you why core level spectroscopy is so interesting and why it's difficult for theory. What you see on this slide is the aerial picture of DESI. So in Hamburg, that's where I spent my last year sabbatical, and it was great fun to watch innovative ways to produce light in very different regimes. And that allows scientists to probe matter in a very unorthodox way. But in order for this multi-billion facilities and these novel light sources to be useful, we need to have theoretical tools that will help to interpret experiments and translate spectroscopic data into what we actually want to know, what molecules and atoms are doing, and make the spectral assignments. So this is no different from normal, more traditional spectroscopies. So I will tell you about what are difficulties for theory and what type of methods for core level states we have in QCAM. And then I will highlight some recent applications to illustrate the utility of these methods. All right, core level spectroscopies, what are they? When we use high energy radiation and when we have enough photons in this range, we can observe excitation and ionization and other transitions involving core electrons. So several types of such spectroscopies are illustrated here. For example, we can excite core electron into some valence orbitals, and that gives rise to X-ray absorption spectroscopy, which is an X-ray analog of UVV spectroscopy, where we excite valence orbit electrons. You can also kick out electron from core level and detect photoelectron signal, and that would give rise to X-ray photoelectron spectroscopy, which is obviously an analog of valence photoionization spectroscopy. If you created a hole in a core orbital, then you can observe Auger relaxation of electrons from valence orbitals filling this hole and emitting photons. And by doing so, you can record X-ray emission spectroscopy signal. So finally, I have here an example of very interesting nonlinear spectroscopy called resonance inelastic X-ray scattering. And in this technique, one can excite core electron and coherently observe relaxation of another valence electron filling the hole. So these are several techniques that we have in our disposals. You see that they are similar to valence techniques, but what is common in all them is that they involve core orbitals. And in order to understand utility of these techniques and also challenges that theory experience, it's important to understand special features of core orbitals. So First, core orbitals are very compact and they are localized. So that is very nice property. And consequences of it is that energies of core orbitals are element specific. For example, oxygen H lies at around 500 electron volts. Carbon H is at 300 electron volts. So these transitions involving different edges are very easy to distinguish spectroscopically. So these core orbitals are also sensitive to local environment. And because they are local and sensitive to local environment, you can imagine a lot of a potential of studying very complex system and learn about local environment of, let's say, different protein residues and so on. So this is all great. We can now ask a question whether or not we can apply standard electronic structure method to study these transitions involving core orbitals. So, and here I want to outline difficulties that theory faces if, you know, we want to model these spectroscopies. So the first challenge is that since we are talking about ionized and excited states, we always encounter open shell character and sometimes quite complex multi-configurational wave functions. This is no different from normal UVV spectroscopy. What we also encounter in core level spectroscopies are strong orbital relaxation effects. Now, these are really strong, much stronger than those that we encounter in valence spectroscopy. So, and that requires special treatment. Now, the second two challenges are really very difficult. So, because core states are so high in energy at hundreds of electron volts, it means that there are a lot of states below them. There are multiple valence excited states below this core ionized or core excited states. And it also means that these states are way above the onset of ionization continuum. So they are embedded in the continuum, which makes them resonances that can decay throughout ionization. And that poses really big challenge to electronic structure. So what can we do? There are a number of approaches that allow one to tackle these core states, and I divided them into four broad categories, going from the simplest tricks and methods, some of them, as you see, based on Koopman theorem, that allows us to get quite useful information. I will talk then about state-specific methods that try to describe core states in the same way we describe ground state of the system. We'll mention time-dependent density functional treatment of the states, and bulk of my talk will focus on correlated methods, such as equation of motion coupled cluster and algebraic diagrammatic constructions. And these methods are highly accurate and robust and allow one to obtain very reliable results that are systematically converged. So I will tell you how these methods are extended to core-level spectroscopies. Okay, let's begin. So Koopman theorem, we all like it because it's a very simple way to understand ionization and even to some extent excited states. So what Koopman theorem says is that if one carries over Hartree-Fock calculation or Kohn-Sham calculations to that matter, then orbital energies approximate ionization potentials, and one can also estimate excitation energies, such as in excess transitions, for example, as energy differences between orbital energies. So one can also estimate transition dipole moments that correspond to this transition by computing simple matrix elements between the molecular orbitals. So it's very attractive because it's fast and simple. You just run single SCF calculation and you have more or less everything. It also correctly tackles degeneracy patterns if you have degenerate molecular orbitals. So Koopman theorem gives you correct a picture of that, and also it doesn't break symmetry. Now, okay, so it's all nice, but what are disadvantages? Accuracy is a problem, and that especially true when we go to core levels, because as I mentioned, core relaxation, which is not described by Koopman theorem, is very important. This approach also doesn't resolve singlets and triplets because you do not have spin symmetry built in. And, you know, you cannot improve it much because you get what you get. So now, this said, there are still several tricks that you can play that greatly improve the quality of the results that one can extract from such an approach. For example, if you want to calculate XESS, X-ray emission spectroscopy, as illustrated here, one can apply Koopman theorem within Kohn-Sham density functional theory. That means that you will look at Kohn-Sham orbitals to understand the transitions between XESS. And the results of a very reasonable quality can be obtained if you use short-range corrected functionals. Now, I will refer you to this paper by Nick Bestley and co-workers, which explain exactly how it works, and also explain the rationale for using short-range corrected functionals. Here is an example how such calculations can be performed. So this is an example for water molecule. So to do such XESS calculations, you will just set up calculation for water in its neutral ground state. You see that charge is zero and multiplicity is one. It means I'm doing calculation on singlet state of water. Then I specify method, and that's one of the recommended functionals. And then I specify how many core and valence transitions I want to calculate. And this calculation will compute all XESS transitions with respect to the core orbital. So you can find this input in the collection of inputs that we prepared to accompany this webinar. So alternative approach that allows one to get decent results by using Koopman theorem is called transition potential density functional theory. So you can read about the rationale behind this approach in these publications listed at the bottom of the page. But basically, the way it works is very simple. What one can do is perform Kohn-Sham density functional calculations, but with fractional occupations of molecular orbitals. So what it allows one to achieve is to get somewhat better description of these core relaxation effects that are not well described by Koopman theorem. So once you do such calculations, then you can use Koopman theorem to compute XESS transitions or even XAS transitions. So examples of this method, of using this method, are given in these two inputs that accompany the webinar. All right, so Koopman theorem, great, and there are tricks to get decent results from it, but what if we want something a little bit more accurate and improvable? The second family of methods that I want to highlight are methods based on MOM algorithm. They are state-specific methods, which means that you will need to compute more than one state in order to understand the spectrum, and we call them also delta E because energy relevant to spectroscopic transitions are computed as energy differences of total, as differences of total energies from separate calculations. Okay, let me tell you what it is. So MOM method is called, it's a maximum overlap method, and it's a very general and very useful tool that QCAM offers. This tool allows one to compute excited SCF solutions. So, for example, if you do Hartree-Fock calculations or Kohn-Sham calculations with the default procedure for water cation. So water with charge plus one and multiplicity two. So the solvers will find you the lowest variational solution in a given basis, which would correspond to water molecule with a single electron occupying this higher orbital, higher occupied orbital in water. So you will hole in HOMO of water. So that's the correct behavior, and that's exactly how Hartree-Fock procedure should behave. Now, what MOM allows you to do, it allows you to execute some control, and you can request SCF procedure to find you variational solution that has maximum overlap, that resembles the most specific guess you feed it. For example, you can take orbitals from normal water calculation and then tell SCF procedure that you want solution that in which orbital occupation are specified as on this second diagram from left, where you have hole on core orbital. So how to achieve that? You need to activate MOM keyword, this MOM start keyword equal to one, and then you need to specify how do you want to occupy your orbital. And it says that I want to occupy alpha orbital exactly as they were occupied in the closed shell calculation. But then for beta orbitals, I want to occupy them starting from the second orbital, meaning that I leave a hole in core orbital. So example for such calculation is given in water core MOM input. And in this approach, you can calculate all kind of excited configurations, including core ionized states. So, what are advantages of this approach? Well, you can use it with various methods in principle. You can use MOM with density functional, not just with Hartree-Fock. You can even deploy this method with correlated methods, such as MP2, or even with some care, with coupled clusters. And if you do so, you can compute core ionized or core excited states. So what is good about this approach is that orbital relaxation is well described, because you solve SCF equations for core ionized or core excited state. So this is great. Now, what are disadvantages? Well, disadvantages are that you need to do quite a lot of work. You need to compute each state separately and calculate your ionization or excitation energies as energy differences. Now, you can also encounter spin contamination, which might be relatively small if you look at core ionized states, as shown on this upper diagram. In this case, it's not a big deal, but it becomes a real problem when you calculate determinants, calculate MOM solutions corresponding to excited states, because then you really cannot have properly spin-adapted solution. Other problems, if you have degenerate orbitals, MOM solutions will not honor the degeneracy, so there is a symmetry breaking issues and so on. And it's important to know that convergence of correlated methods may be poor. For example, coupled cluster procedure often doesn't converge unless you make very special steps. Anyway, so MOM method is very useful, and we are using it quite often for core ionizations and core excitations, and there are much more detailed presentation and discussion with example in this paper and in other feature articles which I mentioned later. Okay, so what's next? The next two type of methods are proper excited state methods, methods that describe excited or ionized states by diagonalizing some effective Hamiltonian. So I will first present time-dependent density functional family of methods, and then move on to correlated methods. All right, so how can we apply density functional theory to describe this type of spectroscopies? I have here two examples. First example is the same calculation of excess that we discussed, which, you know, we can describe by using Koopman theorem. But here I take alternative approach. I do calculation on open shell doublet reference, and I use MOM to obtain a solution that corresponds to core ionized state. So you see in this calculation, I specify again the same occupation of core orbitals to get the core level states as before. Then I run TDDFT calculation on this and request 5 roots in this case. And what comes out from such calculation are TDDFT excitation energies. They are coming out with negative energies because in this case, my excitations, my lowest excitations will correspond to relaxation of valence electrons to this unoccupied orbital that become virtual orbital. And in this calculation, you may argue that you have a little bit more variational flexibility to describe the transition. So I will not comment which method is better. You can find more about it in a literature that will be suggested for further reading at the end of the webinar. So another example of application of TDDFT to compute core level transition is shown here. If you are interested in X-ray adsorption spectroscopy, if you want to excite core electrons and not ionize them, then you can apply in principle TDDFT, but with a couple of tricks. So in QCAM, manual is called TRNSS, truncated single excitation space. And what this method is doing, it allows you to customize the target excitation space within TDDFT and CIS. For example, in the input that is shown here, we use this version of truncation where we tell QCAM to include only excitation that involve core orbital. In this case, just one core orbital. This is 1s orbital of oxygen. So as you will see later, this is actually equivalent to using so-called core valence separation within TDDFT. And by doing this, you remove all other low-lying valence states and calculate directly core level states. So it makes the calculations much cheaper and much more fast. So you can look at the example for such calculation in this input provided with the webinar. So how? What are the recommendations for using this method? Again, it's also recommended to be used with short-range corrected functionals. As I said, in some settings, it is equivalent to core valence separation applied to TDDFT, and you can find much more detailed and in-depth description of this method and example in this paper. All right, so now we are moving to point number 4 on my plan, correlated methods with core valence separation, equation of motion coupled clusters, and algebraic diagrammatic construction. So this is the closest area to my research, and I really love correlated wave function methods for a very simple reason. They give us right answer for the right reason. And we know exactly what to expect and we know how to improve it. So QCAM has a lot of correlated methods for excited states. You can find very detailed description in chapter 6 of the manual. So the two main flavors that I want to highlight today are equation of motion coupled cluster methods and ADC methods. So what we do in equation of motion coupled cluster methods, we do coupled cluster calculation for the ground state. And then we describe target states by diagonalizing this similarity transformed Hamiltonian, this effective Hamiltonian that includes a lot of correlations through this similarity transformation performed using coupled cluster amplitudes. So how do we diagonalize this Hamiltonian? We can diagonalize it over different Fock spaces. We can diagonalize it over excited determinants, singly and doubly excited determinants. And by doing so, we can describe excited state of the system. So this is a method for electronically excited states. We can also diagonalize this Hamiltonian over ionized states, states that have one electron less. And by doing so, we can describe ionized states, ground and excited, and so on. So these are great family of methods. They are quite reasonably accurate when you use single and double excitations. So they're systematically improvable. If you put triples in, you will get higher accuracy. We also have some approximations to these methods. We call them EMMP2. They allow one to cut the cost somewhat. Now, what are ADC methods? They have a similar scaling and similar advantages. And in these methods, you also diagonalize an effective Hamiltonian in the space of target configuration. Exactly like for UMEE, you can diagonalize ADC effective Hamiltonian in the space of excited determinants. In ADC for ionization potentials, you will diagonalize ADC effective Hamiltonian in the space of ionized determinants and so on. So the difference between two methods is in how you construct your effective Hamiltonian. And in the recommended literature, you can go to original papers and read them to understand the difference and relative merits of the approach. But for the purpose of today's talk, I really will focus mostly on coupled cluster methods, equation of motion coupled cluster methods, and a lot of the features that are available for UM are also available for EDC. So a lot of things apply equally to both methods. So great methods with long track record of useful work in modeling spectroscopy in the valence regime. The question is, can we adapt these great methods to compute core level states? And here again, we are reminded by the problems with core states. So in principle, it sounds like not a big deal to diagonalize your effective Hamiltonian targeting core level states, whether excited or ionized. There are, you know, ways to modify solvers to do that. But practically, there are, you know, two important issues that stem from these two features. As I already mentioned, core states are high in energy, so there are hundreds of states below them. This itself is not a big problem. A bigger problem is that these core states are metastable with respect to electron detachment because they are embedded in ionization continuum. They appear way above the onset of ionization, as illustrated on this diagram. So that creates big problems, especially for correlated methods. So if you would attempt to describe these highly excited states, or any type of resonance, for so to say, by normal excited state method, you will observe behavior similar to what is illustrated on the slide for low line resonance. You will see that in decent basis sets, your target state that has well-defined character will get dissolved in the sea of multiple states that are dark And if you look at their respective orbital composition, you will see that the states describe the continuum. So in these states, your electrons are trying to get as far from the core as possible, because, again, the physics of the problem is, if you are above ionization energy, your states are coupled to the continuum and electrons are out-ionizing. So it's a big nuisance. If you try, nevertheless, to compute core level states using standard approaches, you will encounter a lot of nonsense. You will see non-convergent behavior. You will obtain erratic results even when you manage to converge your results. And yes, there is no strategy to make it better for reasons we very well understand. So luckily, we have a good solution for that. And the solution dates back to 1980s, where Cederbaum and co-workers proposed the following trick. So they noticed that one can remove the continuum from your calculations by removing a bunch of electronic configurations that describe this continuum. And for core level states, it's very clear what these configurations are. So the application, the idea of this approach is shown on this diagram. So what you see on the left diagram, you see core ionized state, and two dotted arrows show that this state can decay into the continuum by letting one valence electron to fill the hole, and it liberates enough energy to kick out another valence electron into the continuum. So what is important is that this decay is two electron step. It means that if I consider only singly excited single ionized core states, they cannot decay into the continuum. If I consider also configurations where I have a hole in the core orbital and one electron is excited, these configurations also cannot decay in the continuum. And what facilitates the decay are configurations of two-hole, one-particle type in which core orbitals are not involved. So the recipe then is very simple. Let's remove the continuum by retaining only the configurations where at least one core orbital is involved. So that's a core valence separation. So what happens when you do so? Instead of really huge spectrum of the original problem that you see on the far left of the slide, including the continuum, you end up only with core states, and you remove also low-lying valence excited and ionized states, and you remove the continuum. So very neat idea. So here it shows what it means in terms of the matrix of the effective Hamiltonian. So it shows you that quite big fraction of configuration is removed, giving rise to this very compact manifold of target states. And what it does, it blocks decay channels by stabilizing the resonances. So they no longer know that they are resonances because the decay channels are removed. And we also remove large manifold of valence excited states such that the core states appear as lowest solutions. So it's added convenience. So the idea is old, and it can be used in many different flavors, and it has been used in ADC by Andreas Droev and his collaborators, and you can read this review that describes some applications. Now, Sonia Coriani and Henry Koch implemented this idea within coupled cluster theory, and of course it works great in coupled cluster theory, and with the help of Sonia Coriani and her group, we now have this methodology available in QCAM. So what this core valence separation, equation of motion coupled cluster methods allows you to do, it provides very robust extension of regular equation of motion to describe core ionized and core excited states. So the same idea works great for two types of spectroscopies. So core level states are computed as well-behaved discrete states. And what is nice about this approach is that it's not only that we can compute core level states, we also can compute valence states within the same framework. And by doing so, we can describe two types of states in a balanced way, and we also can compute transition properties between states. And that's, of course, very important for modeling spectroscopy, because without transition properties, you cannot get intensities and so on. So the method works very well already at doubles level. So the spectral shape is reproduced very good. Now, there is, of course, errors in the peak in the spectrum onset. So absolute peak positions need to be shifted by 0.3 to 1 electron volt, which is not that much if you consider that we talk about transitions that occur at hundreds of electron volts. So what features do we have available? Quite a few of them. Core valence separated equation of motion methods are available for UMIP variant of this theory. So that can be used to describe XPS and XES, and I will show you some examples. Core valence separation combined with UOM for excitation energies can be used to describe X-ray absorption spectra, and I will show you an example of that too. So I'm very excited to report that we also have core valence separation applied to response properties, and that allows one to use this idea to compute nonlinear spectra involving core orbitals, such as resonance and elastic X-ray scattering. So and I will show you an example of that too. So our implementation works for closed and open shell references, which is nice. So I will show you how to apply these tools for time-resolved experiments when one would probe by these methods electronically excited states of the system. And the calculation of energies is augmented by transition dipole moments, by Dyson orbitals, natural transition orbitals, and all these useful things that one need to have in order to have a complete description of experimental observations. So the method is actively developed and new features are coming soon. Spin orbit couplings will become available very soon. Extension to double ionized states and so on. Now, a number of similar features are also available in IDC, but as I said today, I will highlight mostly UMCC family of methods. All right, examples, as promised. Here is a reference to a paper which just appeared in PCCP, can be downloaded from the website. And in this paper, we considered benzene, which is a great molecule because it is very beautiful and has high symmetry. And it's also a pretty tough cookie for electronic structure. And what makes it challenging is that we have in this molecule a lot of degeneracies, which means that proper electronic structure method should be able to honor this degeneracy and not break it. And equation of motion coupled cluster theory does that. You see that we have here multiple core orbitals of different symmetries, and that will have very interesting consequences for the spectra. And we know from valence spectroscopy of benzene that low-lying states of benzene involve valence and Rydberg orbitals, so the methodology should be able to describe valence and Rydberg character in a balanced way. And again, equation of motion is greater than this. So I will illustrate the capabilities of the methods by showing you an example of calculation when we computed X-ray absorption spectrum of benzene, then X-ray emission spectrum of benzene, and then nonlinear spectrum resonance inelastic X-ray scattering. Okay, so example number one, X-ray absorption spectroscopy. What is shown here is computed spectrum in red. So you see a number of peaks, and at the bottom panel, you see experimental spectrum. So You see that peak position and intensities are reproduced pretty well. The calculated spectrum is shifted by 0.8 eV, so these are errors due to having just double excitations. So if you want to get rid of them, you need to go to triples, and hopefully eventually we will have the theory implemented. So you can see that experimental spectrum is quite old, but interestingly, the assignment of peaks in experimental spectrum is still debated. So now with our tools, we can calculate natural transition orbitals corresponding to each peak. And what I show here, natural transition orbitals for peak A and B. And by doing so, we can solve this ambiguity and have robust assignments of peak nature. So what you see on this diagram is that the lowest peak A is described as transition from two particular core orbitals, two pi star type orbitals of benzene. It's like LUMO of benzene. So this is valence type transition. And then peak B has this very interesting character. You see that completely different core orbitals are involved. And then you see that target orbitals have this Rydberg character. The transition is actually complicated. So this is XAS. Here we use CVS EOM EE to describe these transitions. And that's how you run this calculation. It's actually a very simple calculation. So what you do, you run your calculation for closed shell benzene. You see charge is zero, multiplicity is one. You specify method, it is equation of motion CCSD, and you specify target states in the same way you specify them for valence calculation, only that you have this prefix CVS EE states now. So this keyword activates CVS calculation, and here I asked five states in each bright EREP. So what is also shown on this slide is how to deploy natural transition orbital analysis. So there are additional keywords, and when you run such calculation, you will get energies, oscillator strengths, and natural transition orbitals corresponding to these transitions. So example, input and output for this calculation are available in the collection of inputs accompanying this webinar. Next example, XES. So we already seen XES spectroscopy for water, but here the situation is much more interesting because we have not one core orbital, but many. So the spectrum become quite rich and is very sensitive to symmetry and to the correct description. So what is shown on the diagram is a computed spectra. Spectrum is computed using EOM IP CCSD with and without CVS. And experimental spectrum, you see that the shape is reproduced really nicely. And yes, we had to shift theoretical spectrum here again by one electron volt for the same reasons as in XAS. And what is important here is that this structure of the spectrum provides a very concrete indication that core orbitals are not localized and they have very distinct symmetry. So if orbitals were localized, then the spectrum would be completely different. How do we run such calculations? Again, in a very simple way. So it's a little bit, it's more expensive, but conceptually no more complicated than applying Koopman theorem, so only with correlation. So again, here we run calculation for a neutral molecule, charge zero, multiplicity one, it's a singlet state. Then we deploy UMCCSD method, and we ask, in this case, for two sets of states. I ask for valence states, that specified for IP states, and you know, this string asks for all singly ionized states of benzene, Koopmans like states of benzene. So the next red line is CVS IP states. So here I request to compute core ionized states in each rep where the states exist. So by doing this calculation, I have both valence and coionized states. And then I can compute transitions between them, which is specified by this CC transprop keyword. So once this calculation is done, I have complete set of data to construct XeS spectrum. So example is embedding XeS in. All right, now the fun one, RIGS, resonance inelastic X-ray scattering. To remind you what RIGS is, it's shown here on the diagram on the right. In RIGS spectroscopy, it's a Raman-like coherent process. We excite one electron in X-ray regime. So we have one photon coming in, exciting electron from core to some virtual level. And then the second electron relaxes and fills the core by emitting a photon. So one photon in, one photon out. It's a two-dimensional spectroscopy. So what is shown on this map is this two-dimensional map where on the y-axis we have pumping frequency when we tune X-ray radiation and increase energy from 285 to 230. And what is shown on y-axis is energy loss. So it's difference between photons that went in and photons that came out. So by analyzing the spectrum, you can get very rich information about valence excited states of benzene probed through the core. So because of that, the selection rules are different. So you can actually get information which is not available from regular valence spectroscopy. So it's a complementary technique. And it has a lot of other advantages. So how this calculation was carried out? It was carried out using QMEE CCSD method with CVS and with CVS engaged in the response domain. So this is an example of input of how one would set up such RIGS calculation. So this calculation computes energy loss spectrum for excitation to a particular peak of benzene, so that this peak A, and you can read paper to understand what exactly it is. So, and input is again rather simple. You need to tell how many excited states of neutral benzene you want to include, because this tells you how far in energy loss spectrum you can go. Then you specify, you activate RIGS by this CCUM RIGS keyword, and we tried different algorithms for different ways to solve response equations. So for now, this is the recommended one. So, and then you need to specify a frequency of pumping photon, and it's done by this keyword omega one, and this is done in wave numbers. And then you also need to specify at times is energy step, if you want to pump the frequency, and how many points you want to compute. So this is given by two next numbers here. And the second quantity that you need to specify is a damping factor, because here we use damped response theory, and damped factor is specified in atomic units. So the value shown here, 0.005, is very reasonable, and we can use it as a default value. So what are important additional points to remember? I hope that this collection of features and sample inputs already provide useful starting point, but there are of course additional considerations. For example, if you calculate too many states, sometimes when convergence is slow, you can observe failure of Davidson procedure when it will just fail to converge to the proper states. And in these cases, using CVS UM shift keyword helps to obtain more robust convergence. So it's described in the manual, and in principle, it's recommended to use in this calculation. Now, the second important aspect to understand is what happens with the core, because Cores can be frozen in many different ways, and one need to be mindful of that. So if you just use CVS EMCC, QCAM use default frozen core, which may not be so good for all calculation. So what it allows you to do is to compute CVS states corresponding to the highest core orbital. So if you want to calculate multiple transitions, then you need to carry out separate calculation for each edge and to set core properly for each calculation. For example, if you have molecule with carbon, nitrogen, and oxygen, if you want to compute carbon edge, you run calculation and freezing all 1s orbitals on carbon, nitrogen, and oxygen. And then you can comfortably compute your carbon edge. If you want to compute nitrogen edge, you need to freeze fewer orbitals. You only freeze all 1s orbitals on oxygen and nitrogen, and then you can compute nitrogen edge comfortably. So if you want to calculate oxygen edge, likewise, you only freeze only 1s oxygen orbitals and leave nitrogen and carbon edge unfrozen, and then you can compute oxygen edge. All right, I see that we are getting short of time, so but I really want to show this example that shows that one can use some of these techniques to model transient spectroscopy, transient XAS and transient XPS, for example. And in these techniques, which are now being developed experimentally, one would use a probe, one would use something like valence pump, excite valence electrons first, and then come and probe the evolution of excited state. So that's why it's called transient spectroscopy, by core level probe. So this is schematically shown on this diagram. So if you have some molecule and you excite it to a valence state, then you can probe target states by X-ray pump. So now, as it should become clear from this diagram, we have a problem here. If you look at the last configuration on the right, you will see that it's open shell state of doubly excited character with respect to the ground state of the system. And that creates the problems for CCSD. You cannot describe the state by doing normal CVS EE calculation from the closed shell reference. The results will not be sufficiently accurate. So the solution for this problem is that one can do this calculation using excited state reference, and especially triplet reference that has the same orbital occupation as your transient excited state. And in such a variant, you can use CVS-EE or CVS-IP calculations and compute all the transitions, and the results are actually quite nice. So you can see, you can find an application of this trick in these two recent publications, where we used it to model time-resolved XPS and time-resolved XAS spectroscopy. So this is more detailed example that shows how to carry out these calculations. So this is Uracil, and what is shown on the panel on the left are spectra that correspond to ground state core ionization of Uracil, shown in red, and then you can see blue and green. So blue and green spectra correspond to ionization of N pi star excited state and pi star excited state. So you see that they are different. So in principle, you can use these techniques to distinguish which state is excited. And you can model the spectra by setting calculation as shown on the right. For example, you can compute triplet state of the molecule, which has the same orbital occupation of your S1 state, that would be pi star triplet, and then you just run CVS calculation to obtain your target ionized states. And in this example, we also compute Dyson orbitals, which are important to have for the analysis. So you can run the same calculation by finding another triplet on n pi star character, because this is not the lowest triplet. You need to use MOM to find the solution, and this is illustrated in these two examples. All right, to wrap up, equation of motion coupled cluster theory is extended to core level states by using core valence separation. So that allows one to treat core level and valence states on the same footing, which is a way to achieve balance, and also it facilitates calculation of transition properties. So this technique can be used for different types of spectroscopies, including time resolved, XAS and XPS, and by using CVS within damped response theory, we can also describe nonlinear processes involving core electrons, such as RIGS. So, last comment. When you study core level states, it's important to be careful about basis set choice. And if you calculate XAS or RIGS, very often you need diffuse functions, so you need to use augmented basis sets. And you also need to think about orbital relaxation in the valence space and also in the core space. So for valence relaxation, triple zeta quality basis set is sufficient, and of course polarization is important. But to describe core properly, the best results are achieved when you uncontract core. So this strategy appears to be better than, at least more economical than just trying to use correlated core basis sets. For example, we found that uncontracted Popple bases, such as 6311 2++ Gista star, uncontracted on the core, delivers very good accuracy. So that's a useful point to remember. All right, so I will start concluding. QCAM features a wide range of methods for core level states. They range from density functional to coupled cluster theory. I also want to mention that more methods are coming online because there is a very active development in several groups. They develop alternative strategies and try different ideas, so that's very exciting. I would like to thank people who are responsible for all this work. My first thanks goes to QCAM team for their help with implementing our ideas into effective and robust codes, and for allowing us to bring these codes to computational chemistry community to do great science with them. As far as CVS UMCC developments are concerned, my special thanks are Dr. Evgeny Pihanovsky and Dr. Shintian Feng, who helped us to get going with this project. So CVS UM developments are done at USC and in Denmark. So Sonia Cariani is leading this effort, and she and her student Marta, and they implemented most of the CVS UM methods in QCAM, and then Dr. Koshik Nanda at USC, he developed the theory and implemented the code for RIGS calculation by extending nonlinear tools from valence domain to core level domain. MOM developments, I would like to thank Dr. Andrew Gilbert and Professor Peter Gill from University of Sydney in Australia. So, and the CVS ADC developments are carried out by Andreas Droev group in Heidelberg. So finally, one of the very active contributors of DFT methods for core states is Professor Nicholas Besley from Nottingham. And that's it. So if you want to learn more about these methods, I would recommend general reviews on excited states and open shell species. And there is also a webinar on equation of motion coupled cluster methods, which is pretty old, but equation of motion didn't change since then. So I also would recommend reviews on core level methods listed here, and recommend to watch a webinar on core level methods focusing on DFT approaches by Nick Besley from January 2014. And here are some key papers on CVS enabled equation of motion coupled cluster methods that describes the theory and also show examples of how the theory is applied to concrete molecules. And finally, if you want to learn more about QCAM, stay tuned. There are new features advertised on the website all the time. Manual has very detailed information and describes all the new features. Now we have online version of the manual. And there are plenty of webinars. As we were told, this one is number 36. So you can imagine how much information is covered on these webinars. And thank you for your attention, and I will be happy to take questions.
Thank you, Professor Krylov. We have some questions from the audience. The first one is, how reliable is the TDDFT method for core excitation spectroscopy when one has more than one core orbitals?
Oh, so I cannot answer this question because I'm not an expert in TDDFT method, but I would recommend to read this paper and other paper from Nick Besley, who is really an expert in this. And I believe he has examples of multiple cores, and I think in some cases he recommends using different short-range corrected functional to achieve good performance for multiple cores. And you can also watch his webinar, but I have only superficial knowledge of performance of TDDFT for core states.
Thank you. On the page 25, is there a rationale to choose the shifting spectra by 0.3 to 1 eV? And why do we have the offset?
This spectrum, for example, there is no rationale. It's just you have the spectrum, you see the intensity, and you shift to achieve best alignment. So shifts are very common in these calculations. I think shifts that you observe here, 1.2 eV for XS, is kind of relatively small compared to how much people shift spectra in DFT. The rationale for magnitude of shift, no, there is no rationale, but yes, there is a rationale for understanding why there is a shift, because we have limited description of correlation. So that's it. So shifts here. These spectra are not shifted because we don't have experiments, so the appearance is. So does it answer your question?
Mm-hmm. Thank you. So is there a script or option in QCAM to plot the acceptation spectra from the transition energy intensities?
QCAM doesn't generate such files, so we usually plot the spectra by running Python scripts. And I think in principle, in the future, we can provide the scripts as part of the scripts collections we have in QCAM bin directory when we have scripts for auxiliary tasks like that.
Thank you. The next question, what is the limit for the total number of electrons basis functions for CVS EOM CCSD for computing excess spectra? And would it work for the transition metal ion complexes?
Yeah, you can push this methodology pretty far. So CVS is actually slightly less expensive than regular UME calculations because we truncate target states. So that's additional benefit of CVS approximation. So with the valence states, we looked at these coupled cluster methods. We computed pretty large molecular magnets with two copper atoms and large ligands. One can do C60 quite easily. So So like porphyrin with a transition metal is doable. So I think we can do on a single node with sufficiently large memory, it's about 1,000 basis functions. So there are additional ways to increase the size of the systems by using this UMMP2 variant and resolution of identity and Kolesky decomposition. This is not yet implemented for CVS methods. So that would be a good motivation for us to do that. But with current methods, yeah, I think 1,000 basis functions on a good node you can do.
Okay, thank you. So that next question, is the CVS EOM CCSD method applicable for the L3 edge access?
So yes, in principle, you can run this calculation in exactly the same way, but you will need to freeze cores accordingly, right? So you need to freeze all lower lying cores up to this one and leave the rest unfrozen. So that will deliver the states, energies, and transitions. Now, the caveat is that to get a good accuracy for these transitions, you already need to worry about spin orbit splittings. And they are not important for like carbon and nitrogen and oxygen edge, but then for heavier elements, they become important. Now, we have spin orbit code almost complete. Marta Vidal has implemented it and is debugging now, and Pavel Pohilka from my group. So the code is coming online soon. And once it's available, then I think you can get quantitative results for this other edges.
Thank you. So next question, how accurate the EOM CCSD methods for the core excited or ionized states for systems containing metals?
So I do not know for core, so because we do not have spin orbit coupling yet, so we cannot compare quantitatively without spin orbit, because spin orbit is important for them. So from valence spectroscopy, we know that accuracy is not, it's about the same as for other elements, provided that your reference state, your ground state, doesn't have multi-reference character. So, well, for multi-reference character, for some cases, we also have variants of theory that can approach, can handle the situation. But so in principle, with a couple of caveats, I would say that once spin orbit is available, we should be able to describe transition metal edges with similar accuracy as this valence, this light element edges.
Thank you. So next question, why can't we freeze the core orbitals and still get an accurate result? Shouldn't we consider all orbital relaxation effects?
So the orbital relaxation effects are critically important. And what we do in, so it's important to realize what is actually done in CVS method. So in our flavor of core valence separation for UAM, we freeze core at CCSD level for the reference, for the ground state. And we know that that's kind of how we usually do coupled cluster calculation. We freeze the core, and that's also how we do valence state calculations. We know that core is not important for valence states. So core will be frozen for valence state calculations. Now, in CVS domain, core is actually the other way, it's not frozen. In CVS domain, in CVS configurational space, as you can see from this diagram, we do include determinants that have one hole at least one hole in core orbitals, right? So these amplitudes of the wave function, single and double, they are active, and they describe core relaxation. And they appear to describe this very strong core relaxation in core ionized and core excited states in a very robust way. What I said here was somewhat confusing. So when I say freeze core, so that means how you define what core is for CVS approximation. And when I say freeze all 1s orbitals to compute carbon age, it means freeze all 1s orbitals in coupled cluster calculation. And in CVS-UMCC calculation, include only target excitations in the target space that include 1s, which include configurations that include 1s orbital, one or two of them active in the configurational space. So I hope that clarifies this point.
Thank you. Next question. You have mentioned EOM MP2 in the beginning. Have you benchmarked it for CVS applications?
Not yet.
Okay.
So we did not, I think, fully link the EOM MP2 with CVS, which is something we should do and benchmark. So I do not know how it will perform. I think it will perform in the same way as for Wallen states, but until we run benchmarks, I cannot be sure.
Okay, we'll move to close the webinar here. And if you have questions later, feel free to contact me. Probably get you in touch with Professor Krylov if it's necessary. I'd like to thank Professor Krylov, first of all, for her great work. The features in this webinar are available in the newest version of QCAN 5.2. I also want to thank all the attendees for listening and participating. You can also find our YouTube channel from our website. There is a list. So if you click on the workshop and webinars, there is a list of our webinars, and each of these will link to YouTube. I also encourage you to check our instructional materials here. These can be used for teaching or just for learning some introductions to QCAN features. Thanks again for everyone for listening, and this concludes our webinar for today. Please give us your feedback. Really appreciate it.
All right. Thank you, everyone, for attending.
We would like to thank Professor Anna Krylov for her excellent presentation, as well as Kuan Yu Lu for organizing, running, and moderating this webinar. We also invite you to visit us on Facebook. Thank you for your participation, and see you at the next webinar.